Tropic Thunder follows a group of stuck-up actors, played by a group of actually stuck-up actors, attempting to create a film about the Vietnam War. After several setbacks in the filming of the fictional movie, the director decides to drop the actors in the middle of the jungle. In doing so, the actors face off against real dangers and must rely upon their acting skills to survive. The project explores several postmodern elements and how they relate to the film. Specifically, we will be applying the elements of representation and identity, the blurred lines between fictional and the real world, the use of a self-referential word, and intertextuality.
Tropic Thunder utilizes flamboyant intertextuality as a foundation for staging critique on the filmmaking industry. The series of trailers that begin the movie while smoothly integrated into the film are obvious examples of ways the director has used intertextuality to convey specific messages to the audience, beginning with Al Pacino's Booty Sweat commercial. This commercial is a highly exaggerated comment on how many actors will utilize their talents and social prowess to promote ridiculous products that otherwise would not sell or even get noticed. It is an exploitation of the fans' trust and a realistic look into the pretense around the celebrity-fan relationship. Following that is a trailer for Scorcher 6 that sped through five other prequels of similar plots and premises.
The one man who made a difference five times before is about to make a difference again. Only this time, it's different.
It created a mockery of the current business model of repeating the same but slightly altered movie plot over and over that many large film franchises often pursue. This trailer produces a powerful statement on how the significance and meaning of the movie decreases over time as more and more sequels are produced simply in the interest of box office profits. Lastly was the trailer about The Fatties. This trailer serves as a critique of the crude and repetitive approach to creating artificial humor in comedies. It is a trailer entirely about farts, and since every character is so trite and dimensionless, they all might as well be played by the exact same character, which ironically is exactly what is happening in the trailer. By embedding these critiques inside other types of texts, Tropic Thunder is able to highlight the flaws in the movie industry in a sophisticated and postmodern way.
Tropic Thunder exemplifies the postmodern element of the self-referential work. The film is a nesting of the concept of filmmaking. It is a film of a film about making a film.
Perfect blunder, the true story behind the making of the most expensive fake true war story ever.
This layered abstraction gives rise to commentary on other works in real life and the acting community in general through parody about Hollywood and the filmmaking process. The beginning of the film tackles the issue of exaggerated war storytelling with the scene of the main cast acting out ridiculously infeasible stunts based off of a supposedly true story. It is as if everything falls into place beautifully at the right time, up until they mess up and scorch half the forest. Another point that Tropic Thunder makes is the occasional disingenuous PSA celebrities make for causes that they are not particularly invested in. This is parodied by Tug Speedman, who advocates for pandas in real life, but actually ends up killing one while making the movie. While he shows remorse for doing so, it is a statement about the disconnect between actors and the cause that they are putting their faces on. Lastly, the film parodies the casting of the wrong race for roles meant for a specific race. Sergeant Osiris is an African-American in the story, but is portrayed by a white man with darkened skin, in this case, Robert Downey Jr. Survive! This is commentary on how often roles are misrepresented by the wrong races. The film also subtly tackles the casting of one Asian group to portray another Asian group. The Asians in the movie were supposed to be Vietnamese, however they are portrayed by Chinese-speaking actors. All in all, Tropic Thunder is deeper than just a comedic film. It's a postmodernist work that highlights the inconsistencies of the movie-making industry.
One of the main elements of postmodernism in film is the blurred lines between the fictional and the real world. As a film depicting actors filming a movie, Tropic Thunder is able to explore the flexible boundaries between the two. To set up the scene, the movie director has decided to drop the actors in the middle of the jungle, intending to use hidden cameras and special effects to create a more realistic film.
We have rigged this entire Valley of Death with hidden cameras.
Unbeknownst to the director, they've all been placed in real danger, with the actors actually being dropped into the middle of the Golden Triangle, one of Asia's main opium-producing regions.
You wanted to be actors? You wanted to occupy the skin of another human being?
In the scene, the director Damien has just explained his new guerrilla filming strategy for the film. After pumping up the actors, he accidentally steps on an old landmine and is blown up. Tug Speedman, the Ben Stiller character, attributes the death to an advanced special effects used to inspire the actors to give better performances.
It's corn syrup, guys. Corn syrup and latex. Warm, blood-flavored corn syrup.
As viewers, we are constantly reminded of the fictional nature of the films and its depictions. Real actors are playing actors as characters who are making a fake movie. Within the film, we are shown scenes of the actors as themselves and actors playing characters in the fake film. However, these distinctions are constantly blurred. In the scene, Damien advocates for the guerrilla-style technique of filming to provide a more realistic effect for his fictional Vietnam War movie.
The whole thing guerrilla-style. Gritty, dirty, get them away from their helpers and arse-sticking assistants. Put them in the real shit.
With real fear in their eyes. Real fear, real emotion.
Damien is ultimately killed when his search for realistic fiction confronts him with actual reality. In Tug Spearman's fictional reality, his experience in action movies has taught him that death and general violence are caused by special effects teams, to the point where he cannot fathom the occurrence of actual violence.
Were there some rewrites that I missed?
Speedman believes that when acting in a movie, his reality is fictionalized.
Postmodernism examines the idea of representation and identity. If you represent an object in a different way, it is still the same object? Is Magritte's painting of a pipe really not a pipe? We recognize the painting as a painting of a pipe not because we are aware of the physical pipe that we use as a model, but rather because we are socialized to understand what a typical pipe looks like. Tropic Thunder plays on this idea by introducing an actor, Kirk Lazarus, who fully dives into every role he plays. Just like he says,
"Man, I don't drop character till I've done a DVD commentary."
Lazarus is so invested in the character he plays that he seems to have lost sight of who he actually is. Too many representations of himself have led to an eroding of his original self. In one scene, Speedman confronts Lazarus about how deep he has gone into his role.
Who are you?
Me? I know who I am! I'm a dude playing a dude disguised as another dude! You a dude that don't know what duty is!
Or are you a dude who has no idea what duty is and claims to know what duty is by playing other dudes?
I know what dude I am!
After which Lazarus breaks down and confesses that,
Sergeant Lincoln, Luther. I think I might be nobody.
So while Lazarus' different acting roles merely a difference in perspective looking at the same person, or are they actually legitimate different people? In looking at representation, we can also look at just how the actors in the film choose to play different roles. Lazarus' portrayal of a black man is called out for being racist, as his black mannerisms have no basis in reality.
Hell yeah! Ha!
Hell yeah! Ha! That's how we all talk. We all talk like this, huh? Yes, sir, huh? Yeah, get some crawfish and some ribs, ha! Yeah! You're Australian!
However, the idea of representation is that there is no objective reality from which to draw our interpretations. Likewise, Lazarus can only draw on the socialized interpretation of what being black is like, since he is not actually black himself. In the same way, Cruz plays the producer as someone who only cares about money, while McConaughey plays the agent as someone fiercely loyal to the actor.
My friend wants a Devo! My friend gets a Devo!
These representations are all not based in objective reality, but are rather colored through the lenses through which Cruz and McConaughey, both famous actors, perceive these people in their daily lives.
At the end of the film, the actors have gained a new perspective on the relationship between their work as actors and their personal identities. As viewers watching the making of a movie through the perspective of the agent, actor, director, and drug lord, we as viewers have also gained a valuable perspective into the complex social interconnections necessary for creating a film. The real question is, what's next?